Northside. I am excited to have my fifth and sixth grade girls come up here. Go ahead, girls. Don't be afraid. I have our girls, our ladies up here this morning because they went through the My Faith Catechism class that was about 5 weeks long through January and February, and we spent concentrated time, an hour and a half each week, going through what the Church Universal and the Church of the Nazarene believes. We talked about the Trinity, sin, salvation, sanctification, end times, the church, all those things that you would think would be covered in catechism class. And we also worked on memorizing the Apostles' Creed, and three of them succeeded in doing that. The other two, I think, are still working on it, but I'm just really proud of them for coming and sticking it out. And you know, sometimes those conversations are really interesting, sometimes they're not so interesting, but they were there and they were involved, and they also had the opportunity to anonymously write down any questions they had about the church. And I wasn't really sure what to expect, but there was some very deep questions. So our ladies who are going to be moving up here in the next year or two are really interacting with God and thinking about their faith and what that means to them. So I just want to congratulate them for finishing and hand out their certificates. And those girls that finished, the girls that did memorize the Apostles' Creed, they earned a gift card as well. So they will be getting both of those items. Can you give them one more round of applause?
Well, congratulations, girls. I had the privilege of teaching one of those classes 1 week, and I am no longer afraid to preach to you anymore. It was an awesome experience. They have some good questions. It's really great to see them seeking after the Lord, so that's an exciting thing. Well, Pastor Dallas.
Yes. I got this one.
Oh, you have a mic. Okay.
We also, in January, we started a teen membership class. And so we spent, I don't know, how many weeks did we talk about stuff? 5 weeks? 6 weeks? Five or six weeks. They all kind of started to blend into each other at the end of it. But we had several students who were interested. There were some who weren't able to make it at that time. So we're going to do another membership class in the summer. But McKenna Smith and Josiah Smith both stayed through the class. They completed the class. They were interested in church membership. And so this morning, what we're going to do is we're actually going to receive them into membership here in the Church of the Nazarene. So Josiah and McKenna, would you guys come? So you can't have these until after you go through this ritual with Pastor Tim. But that one's for you. That's your certificate. So Pastor Tim, I present these two candidates for membership in the Church of the Nazarene.
Awesome. Awesome. Let's give them a round of applause again. Welcome them. I have some things that I would like to read to you to remind you of what you've learned in church. It's also great for those of you that are members or those of you that are curious in membership to hear these things about our church. Well, dearly beloved, the privilege and blessings that we have in association together in the Church of Jesus Christ are very sacred and precious. There is in it in such hallowed fellowship as cannot otherwise be known. There is such helpfulness with brotherly watch and care and counsel as can be found only in the church. There is the godly care of pastors with the teachings of the word and the helpful inspiration of corporate worship. And there is cooperation in service, accomplishing that which cannot otherwise be done. The doctrines upon which the church rests as essential to Christian experience are brief. So I have a statement that I want to read to you guys. It says, "We believe in one God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe that the Old and New Testament scriptures, given by plenary inspiration, contain all truth necessary to faith and Christian living. That all humanity is born with a fallen nature and is therefore inclined to evil and that continually. That the final impenitent are hopelessly and eternally lost. That the atonement through Jesus Christ is for the whole human race. And that whosoever repents and believes on the Lord Jesus Christ is justified and regenerated and saved from the dominion of sin. We believe that believers are to be sanctified wholly, subsequent to regeneration through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We believe the Holy Spirit bears witness to this new birth and also to the entire sanctification of believers. We believe that our Lord will return, the dead will be raised, and the final judgment will take place. I want to ask both of you, Josiah and McKenna, do you heartily believe these truths? If so, would you answer, I do? Do you both acknowledge Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? And do you realize that He saves you now? If so, would you answer, I do? Desiring to unite with the Church of the Nazarene, do you covenant to give yourself to the fellowship and to the work of God in connection with it, as set forth in the covenant of Christian character and the covenant of Christian conduct of the Church of the Nazarene? Will you endeavor in every way to glorify God by a humble walk, godly conversation, and holy service, by devotedly giving of your means, by faithful attendance upon the means of grace, and abstaining from all evil? Will you seek earnestly to perfect holiness of heart and life in the fear of the Lord? If so, would you answer, I will? I want to welcome you into the church, to its sacred fellowship, responsibilities, and privileges. May the great head of the church, Jesus Himself, bless and keep you, and may He enable you to be faithful in all good works, that your life and witness may be effective in leading others to Christ. We welcome you to the Church of the Nazarene. Josiah McKenna, give you a fist bump. Kind of the secret shake right there. There you go. Church, would you welcome them again to the church? Thank you so much. We also want to just take a moment and recognize a couple of transfers that we have. We are thankful that Dallas transferred his membership to Northside. We were kind of wondering about that, but he did it. So we welcome here by transfer Dallas. We also welcome his wife, Kristen, too, as well, into our sacred fellowship. But church, as McKenna and Josiah are heading down, would you all wave at them? Tell them a big howdy-do, and that you're happy to have them as a part of our church. Well, we are working here at Northside to build an inclusive community that loves Jesus and loves people. And one of the most practical ways that you can do that is by showing up every single week to worship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. That's a really easy way to live into that mission. Another way you can do that is by connecting with the people that are around you. You can do that through classes. We've offered some online. Next Sunday, we're starting a brand new class, Sunday morning, 9 a.m., room 113. It's going to be a walkthrough of the book of Ephesians. That's for all ages, so we invite you to come, be a part of that, connect with your brothers and sisters. And then finally, we also want you to be serving somewhere. How can you be plugged in here at Northside? Is it welcoming guests that come in? Is it picking up the offering? Is it saying hi to people? Is it teaching a class? Is it serving our kids and our youth? We want you to find a place to serve. And if you're looking for a place or you're curious about some of this, I want to let you know that right after service, down in room 113, I am going to be teaching a Next Steps class. And this is going to be a brief history of our church, brief history. Don't want to bore you with all of the details, brief history. And then we're going to talk a little bit about our mission and about our purpose as a church, show you how we're organized, and let you see some of the areas that you can serve in. And so if you're curious about Northside, if you would like to get involved, I invite you to join me right at the end of this service in room 113 for my Next Steps class. Well, church, are you excited to be here this morning? We've seen some great things happening. Why don't you stand with me? A couple things just to finish up here. We are still taking an offering. You can give through the app. You can also give by putting something in the offering basket when you leave. But we thank you so much for your generosity, and that has made what we do possible. So hallelujah, praise the Lord. Thank you, church. Thank you, those of you that are tuning in online each week. We are excited to have you as a part of this body too as well. Let's just have a word of prayer, and then we're going to continue worshiping through song this morning. Jesus, I thank you for your many blessings that we've already witnessed this morning. A group of girls that learning about what it means to be a Christian, learning about faith, learning about the church, learning about the Bible, learning about who you are and how we understand you. What an awesome thing. The things that they have been learning, that they have been taught, I know they will carry with them through the rest of their lives. Lord, we thank you for Josiah and McKenna being a part and becoming a part of the Northside Church of the Nazarene by joining in membership. We are excited about that. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord for that. Jesus, we are excited to be able to gather as your people. We're excited to be able to sing songs that talk about who you are, to sing songs that express our love towards you, to sing songs about the good gifts that you have given us. One of those gifts is the Holy Spirit. We just invite your Spirit to fall fresh on us this morning. I don't know how people have been coming in here today. There's probably some that have been excited, that have been happy, that have been feeling good. There are others that have probably been angry, upset, disturbed. I don't know, but you know, and you have a way of meeting us right where we are at. And so would you meet my brothers and sisters wherever they are, right where they are at, and would you speak truth to them? Would you encourage them? Would your Spirit quicken something in their minds that would trigger the hope and remind them of the great hope that we have in you? May we continue to be aware of your presence, of you with us, of you living in us. Lord, would you bless Pastor Dallas as he shares the Word of God with us this morning? Would your Spirit just anoint him as he comes up here? Would you give us ears to hear, a heart to respond? As our teens share with us a skit, Lord, would you use that to speak truth to us too as well? You are an awesome God. We love you. We're excited to continue worshiping you this morning. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Humbleness, oh praise him, Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I live with you. My peace I give you. Do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled, and do not be afraid.
Your glory, God. the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome when your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts.
I'd like one McJesus with cheese. Can I get extra grace on that?
All our McJesuses come with all the grace you need.
Oh, well, that's great. I'd like McJesus just like you serve them. Got fries with that?
You mean French fryers?
That's what we have to call them.
Yes, thank you. How much is that?
Everything McJesus gives is free.
Wow, that's incredible.
Here's your receipt. Your McJesus will arrive at your table soon.
Thank you.
Welcome to the Golden Gates. How may I bless you today?
I like a double McJesus, but I don't want my McJesus to have any real structure.
I'm sorry?
Like, I want a McJesus with inspiration and comforting ideas, minus any requirements or standards on my part. I want a McJesus that not only makes me feel good, but it never makes me question myself.
I'm sorry. We don't serve that here. We only serve one type of McJesus.
What? That can't be.
We know our McJesus is the perfect mix of all the ingredients for a balanced life.
So you can't give me what I want? I've never been told no before in my whole life.
I'm sorry, you can always go to Religion King Jr. just across the street if you want to customize your McJesus. But we can guarantee it won't be the same.
You won't be the same.
You okay?
He's right. After my first real McJesus, I was never the same. How may I bless you today?
I'm looking for a bunch of McJesuses? Yeah, those. My grandparents are hosting a bridge tournament, and I need some food.
That sounds fun.
It's like the most boring thing I've ever heard of. Imagine watching golf on TV where they never actually swing the club.
Well, I can offer you the communion combo, all the bread and juice you need.
As long as it's more than 2 fish and 5 loaves, I'm good.
Here's your receipt. Your communion combo will arrive at your table soon. Welcome to the Golden Gates. How may I bless you today?
Hello. I need a McJesus with plenty of theology, patriology, phenomenology, anthropology, and deontology. But please no eschatology, hamartiology, or soteriology.
I'm sorry, we only serve one kind of McJesus here.
Haven't you been reading? It's extremely archaic and obsolete, even to accept what has been fed to you for so long without examination and rejection of nonsense concepts.
Well, I know about foodology, and surveys show that when our McJesus is delivered and accepted as is, the hungry are filled and the tired are rejuvenated. That's the power of McJesus. It seems simple until it is fully consumed. And then, well, you won't be left wanting. Or with hungerology?
I think I'll pass. That simply makes no sense whatsoever.
If you'll dig in, you'll sense all you need to know. Welcome to the Golden Gates. How may I bless you today?
I need to meet Jesus, but here's the thing. I want it to be good, like really good. I need blessings, hope, peace, and eternal life. But I don't want anything hard, like responsibility, sacrifice, hardships, or difficulties, and all the stuff that I've heard of. I want to bite into McJesus and taste unicorns and rainbows. That's how McJesus should be.
I'm sorry, we serve only one kind of McJesus here. We can't make those changes.
Can I speak to your manager?
How can I bless you today?
Why is your employee here telling me that I can't have a McJesus like I want it? Like, where did you get the idea that there's only one kind of McJesus? People should be able to choose what they prefer, right? I think I want a McJesus, but I don't want it like you say I should have it.
Here's the thing, sir. When you come to McJesus, you're looking for something special, unique, and life-changing. The real McJesus is something you won't find anywhere else, and it's worth every penny and second of your time. We know it's the best thing you'll ever find, but when you start adding what you want and taking away what you don't like, it stops being a McJesus. If you want a McJesus, there's plenty. You can't come in here and demand we serve only what you like, because then it's not McJesus that you want. There's only one best. You either want it with the perfect mix of everything you need, or you don't. You can't change it and expect the same result.
Well, that leaves me with a really hard choice.
It's a choice we all make.
So what will it be? The only real McJesus, or do you want to find a cheap substitute?
I think I need to see the recipe again.
Let's go then.
Amen. That doesn't want to turn off. Sorry. Would you pray with me? Father God, again, we just thank you for who you are. We thank you for your son Jesus and this great reminder message that Jesus doesn't change, that he is enough, he is sufficient. God, would you be with us in this moment of time as we gather here in this place, as we're watching online? We know that wherever we are at, your spirit is there with us. Would you speak to us this morning? Would you help us to hear from you and be challenged by your word? In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I invite you, you can go and get your Bibles ready, but I'll share a little story with you first. I'm glad that we've been doing all these things that we've been doing today, celebrating Alabaster and recognizing the work our students have been putting in to know what the church believes, specifically what our church believes, the Church of the Nazarene. It's exciting to bring in new members to the church, and exciting to be growing in grace. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So, a little bit about me. If you haven't learned this by now, you can take a quick trip around my office. I love superheroes. I have a Batman on my desk. Pastor Tim even got me a little Batmobile as one of my welcome presents when I came. I think there was even a Batman mug. I really love DC superheroes. I can tolerate Marvel. I think all of us, most of us probably been watching WandaVision. I won't give any spoilers, don't worry. But I love superheroes, and I don't know if it's just the kid in me that can't grow up, or if it's, the details of like these stories and what it brings. I love reading through comic books. One of the things my wife and I love doing, we love watching the show Arrow. Anybody fans of Arrow from the CW? It's great. And I think I love it because it's actually like Batman's backstory with like the Green Arrow. But one of the things that I find the most interesting about superheroes is this complex that usually gets associated that when the world is ending or something disastrous is happening, one of the superheroes decides that they're going to make the ultimate sacrifice, right? I have to be the one that gets sacrificed in order to save the world. And what do the rest of the superheroes do? No. There has to be another way. We need you. You can't just sacrifice yourself. Like, we have to come up with another way. And sometimes, depending on how the story is written, sometimes the character does have to end up sacrificing themselves. Sometimes they do find another way. But that's the story of superheroes. That's not scripture. Jesus, some people, anybody remember the old VBS, Jesus is my superhero? We try to associate Jesus as the superhero, but yet Jesus is different. Jesus is different than what we can read about in a comic book, what we can read about in stories. Yes, we can make great comparisons to some of the details from Jesus' life, this idea of self-sacrifice, this idea of being willing to die for someone else. But all of those deaths aren't the same. There's something special about Jesus. There's something special about what Jesus did. Let's turn to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8. We're going to be in verses 31 through 38 this morning. It says this, I'll be reading out the NIV, or, you know, for some of us, the Nazarene International Version, but the New International Version. Verse 31. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and then he must be killed, and after 3 days, raised again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and this sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." This is the word of God. Can be difficult for us to hear those words sometimes, can't it? My Bible wants to keep closing, so I'm going to use that to save my spot. So here's what I want to talk about, because this is not biblical, but this is what I picture going on here. So if you look back right before these passages, Jesus has just asked the disciples, "Who is everybody saying that I am?" And if you look to the Gospel of Matthew, it'll give you some more details. They say, well, some say you're, you know, a prophet. Some say you're Elijah. Some say you're John the Baptist reincarnated. But Jesus then looks at the disciples and he says, "But who do you say that I am? You that I have called to be fishers of men. You that I have called to follow me. Who do you say that I am?" And Peter, in his great revelation, looks at him and says, "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah. You are the one that we've been waiting for." And Jesus says to him, "This is good news because no one has revealed this to you except for my Father in heaven." Peter's got to be feeling pretty good about himself, right? "I've just figured out who the Messiah is, and I got commended for it." And then all of a sudden, Jesus gets this crowd together and he starts talking about that I have to die, that I have to suffer, and that in 3 days I will rise again. And, you know, in their Jewish minds, yeah, they're like, okay, yeah, it makes sense. I mean, if Jesus dies, yeah, like, yeah, he'll rise again. At the end of time, you know, the great resurrection. Yeah, that makes sense. But what do you mean? Jesus, we've been following you. So Peter's like, dude, Jesus, come here. Like, you can't be telling everybody that you're going to die. We have given up everything. We followed you. Like, come on. Like, there's got to be another way. Dude, we need you. There's got to be another way. Jesus goes, "Peter, come here. Get behind me, Satan! You do not have the things of God in mind. You are only worried about what you can see. You can only see this 5 feet in front of you. You can't see the bigger picture." Peter's focus was on the wrong thing. Peter's focus was on the wrong thing. For us, we so easily also can put our focus on the wrong things. We tend to think small picture. We tend to think about what's happening right in front of us in our time. We don't typically have the things of God in mind. We can be just like Peter. We can know all of the right answers, whether that's asking for our numerology, soteriology, all those other things that Aaron said. We can know all of the right answers, and yet we can still get it wrong. Because if our minds are not focused on the things of God. Here's the thing. We don't get to choose our McJesus. We don't get to choose what Jesus looks like. We don't get to choose, pick and choose what parts of Jesus' life we like. We don't get to cut out the parts of sacrifice and self-giving and suffering. Jesus had already faced that temptation. And so when Peter comes to Jesus and he says, dude, there's got to be another way. Jesus' mind goes back to the wilderness. And when the Satan comes to him and he tempts him and he says, listen, you don't have to die for these people. Just bow down to me. Just bow down to me and all of this can be yours. That's what he's calling out in Peter. Our humanity that says, there's got to be another way. I don't have to give up what I want. I don't have to sacrifice. Jesus has already done that for me. But Jesus tells us that if you want to follow me, you must take up your cross and be willing to follow the life that I have lived. The avoidance of the cross had already been a temptation, and Jesus had overcome that temptation. Peter was not focused on the things of God. And that's why God rebuked Peter. And he did it in front of the disciples. Because Peter was speaking for the disciples. Because it wasn't just about one person. It's about the group that's being led. It's about not just the individual. It's about a church that can be led astray. Do you remember what Jesus called Peter? You are Cephas. You are the rock. And on this rock I will build my church. If the church gets it wrong, if the church can't focus our eyes on Jesus, how will we ever be able to take Jesus into the rest of the world? It's a challenge to all of us. And Jesus then, not only does he do this to the disciples, look at what the scripture says. It says he also then, to the disciples and the crowd that was gathered there. This is a call to all. To open their eyes. To see what God wants to do. Here's a question for you. How many times do we try to convince God that we know better about what we need to do? Your toes hurting a little bit? Anybody feel like their toes are getting stepped on? Mine are hurting a little bit. How many times do we try to convince God that we know better than him? But yet, I always love the buts. Don't take that out of context. I got to be careful what I say. Will. How did he lose his job? Well, let me tell you. Psalm 22. Psalm 22, 23 and 24. This was from the Northside Week. This was one of our psalms this week. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel, for he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. For he has not hidden his face from him, but he has listened to his cry for help. This is what God does. When we think that we're alone, when we think that maybe we know what's going on more, yet God listens to us. God listens to our cries for help, that he does not leave us in places that we feel stuck or abandoned. So instead of us trying to convince God that we know better than him, maybe we should listen to what God has already told us in his own scriptures, what he has prophesied through the prophets, what he has told us through the psalmist about how God is faithful to be there with us. If we can focus our eyes on him. The difference here, Jesus definitely was a superhero. He's got super vision. Jesus' vision was perfect because his eyes were focused on the cross. While the disciples saw the Messiah as a conquering figure, Jesus saw himself that was called and was willing to lay down his life and all that he was. He was willing to be despised, scorned, and afflicted because he trusted in the one who sent him. Because he trusted in the one who sent him. A journey to the cross involves trust. A journey to the cross involves trust. So what is the way of the cross? What is this? Verse 34 says, if you want to follow me, you must take up your cross and be willing to go down the path that I have gone down. What does it actually mean for us to take up our cross? We say that, it seems kind of like a Christian pleasantry, right? But what does that actually mean to take up our cross? It means that we're willing to bear whatever comes. To take up your cross in Roman times meant that you literally carried the thing that you were going to be crucified on. People watched you walk down to your death. It was that hill that you were willing to die on. How often are we willing to actually carry the cross? How willing are we to bear that burden? Jesus calls us to live a life as one that he did, one that is willing to sacrifice our comforts and our control and our will and trust God's will. That's a pretty heavy cross, isn't it? How willing are we to carry that cross? Here's the thing. Jesus did not call us to anything more than what he himself was willing to be subjected to. Jesus cannot call us to die to self if he himself was not willing to die for our sins. If Jesus was not willing to suffer, he would not call us to suffer, to bear these things that the world will scorn us for. We talked last Sunday night about Elisha and the people bearing down on him. Bearing down Elisha. It was the she bears. Bearing down on him because they didn't want to hear what Elisha had to say about God. He should just go up. We don't care. There were people who scorned and mocked and ridiculed him because of his belief in God. There are people who will scorn and mock and ridicule. And around the world, people being persecuted and killed and tortured because of their belief in God. What cross are we willing to bear? Do we trust in God? Because here's the thing. Trust results in faith and righteousness. Romans chapter 4, verses 18 through 25. Against all hope, Abraham, in hope, believed, and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet, he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what God had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words "it was credited to him" were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, he was delivered over to death for our sins, and raised to life for our justification. Look back at verse 35. Mark chapter 8, verse 35. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What does that mean? The way of gaining life is by being willing to lose everything that we think defines life. By everything that we think matters. The way of the cross means that we are willing to submit ourselves to the sacrifice and the suffering that will come from following Jesus. So maybe you're asking yourself, how do we now take those steps? How do we journey ourselves to the cross? It takes total commitment. Total commitment to Christ is not just about what we have to sacrifice and suffer, but it is also what we gain by following Christ on this journey. I don't want you to think that following Christ is just about sacrifice. It's just about suffering. Because God has promised that there are things that we gain from faithfully following God. Now, this is not a health and wealth prosperity gospel message, but this is the truth of Scripture. This is what we gain. One of the things that we understand in this offering of what we gain new life by Christ giving of himself on the cross. He says, you are no longer slaves to death. I have conquered death. I am offering you new life. You can be born again in me. That's good news. But what about those that have already been on this journey? What if we already know that truth? What if we already believe that Jesus has died for our sins? What if we have already made a confession that we want Christ in our lives, that we want new life? For some of us, we think that that's it, right? One and done. I prayed the prayer, you know, I'm good, you know, I'm eternally secure, right? Whatever that word means. Maybe we're putting a, we were joking about NASSAFE training, not that NASSAFE training is a joke. Somebody said, what is NASSAFE training? It's where we take Nazarenes and we go put them in the safe. Maybe that's what eternally secure is. Maybe we just go put you in a safe for eternity. But that's not what Christ has promised us. Our lives are not just about guarding them away. We are given new life, not new safety. But what do we do with that new life? Are we willing to follow that journey that Christ has set before us? For us as Nazarenes, we talked about this in, I won't make McKenna or Josiah come up and give an example of this. We talked about this in our membership class. We talked about what this journey looks like. We talked about this journey that everyone is on. The Holy Spirit is working in our lives before we even recognize it. It's the via salutis, the way of salvation. The Holy Spirit is calling to us, longing for us to come back to the relationship with the Father, the relationship with God. And once we make that commitment, once we begin on that journey and we commit our hearts to Christ, we don't just end there. We continue on a journey of self-denial, of reflection, of focusing our eyes on the big picture of what God wants us to do. For us in the Church of the Nazarene, we talk about this as entire sanctification. That moment where we know without a doubt that we have completely trusted God's way. And it still doesn't end there. There's an old school thought that talked about, once I'm there, I'm good. I don't sin anymore. I'm perfect. Woohoo! But it's not. It's a continual journey that we have to be on every single day. Because you know what? We talked about this last week. The spiritual warfare is still happening. The temptation is still there. What does Jesus teach the disciples to pray? Protect us from the evil one. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. This is what God is trying to prepare us for. This moment of entire sanctification is giving ourselves completely over to God, but we still continue on this journey where we still have to make a choice. But will we listen and follow God, or do we put our focus other places? Fred Craddock, a great preacher, once described following God in this way. We think of giving our all to the Lord looks like this. It's taking our lives and taking a $1,000 bill. Anybody ever seen a $1,000 bill? I haven't, so I don't know where Fred Craddock got this from. But anyway, taking a $1,000 bill and laying it on the table. Here you go, God. Some of us think that that's what life is like. But for him, he said, in reality is, we get sent to the bank with that $1,000 bill, and we exchange it for a bunch of quarters. And over time, we, you know, give God 25 cents and maybe 50 cents, and, you know, a little bit at a time we're trusting. And his illustration says that, you know, that's what a life of love looks like, is that giving things over to God 25 cents at a time. And that's not a bad illustration. But for Nazarenes, for me specifically, I have to be willing to have that $1,000. And yeah, at first, you know, I only, you know, give him, you know, a little bit at a time. I give him a few dollars here. I see that he was probably more faithful with it than I was. And so next time I trust him with a little bit more. But entire sanctification, that moment, we put it all on the table. And we say, God, you know better what to do with this than I ever could. I'm going to trust you with it. I want you to lead me. I want you to guide me. Now, that doesn't mean that we put ourselves on autopilot. It doesn't mean that we get to just check out and that God just controls us like some master puppet master, right? We still have a responsibility to be a part of that journey. But we do need to trust the process of where God is leading us. And we need to be willing to join him on that journey. That journey to the cross. The journey to the cross places a call on all of us to make a choice. If you've never made that choice to follow after him, that call is there. Maybe you're someone today who you've been following him for a while, but you have never fully trusted him. That call is to take that next step, to be entirely devoted to God's will, to God's way. This morning we're going to celebrate with communion, this great reminder of what Christ has done for us on that cross, offering us new life. This is a meal not just for the people of God. This is a meal for any who are seeking after God's heart. Whether it's the first time you're on this journey or whether you've been on this journey for a long time, Christ is still calling to us. That's what this meal represents. If you did not receive a communion cup this morning and you'd like to partake with us, please just raise your hand up and our ushers will come and bring forward. If you need a gluten-free wafer, we do have some in a tin down here on the front. Pastor Tim, could you see if there's anybody who needs a gluten-free wafer? This meal is a reminder. Jesus told his disciples three different times that he was going to have to die. And he said, but wait. It's another one of those buts. But wait. I have to die, but I'm coming back again. Amen. This meal is to be a reminder of my sacrifice for you. My body that I was willing to be broken. My blood, which was willing to be spilled, poured out for the redemption of all people. That is the cost of following Christ. Are we willing to take up our cross? This meal this morning is a reminder for us. Would you take your elements? Jesus, as he sat with the disciples, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave thanks and he said, "This is my body, broken for you." Would you take and eat? And after the meal with his disciples, he took the cup. And he told his disciples that this represents my blood. My blood which is poured out for the redemption of all mankind, all humanity. Not just the Jews, the Gentiles, everyone ever born, everyone that ever will be born, everyone who was ever conceived, this blood has been poured out for them for relationship. Would you take and drink? Would you pray with me? Father God, again, we thank you for who you are. God, if you are doing something in our hearts today, would you make it clear to us? God, these altars
are a place where we can come. There's nothing special about these altars. Whether we come to these altars, whether we stay in our seats, whether we wait, and you are speaking to us on our way home or after we get home today. God, if you are calling us to take those steps, to follow you on a journey toward the cross, to be a reminder of what you have already done and what you have called us to, God, would you help us to fix our eyes on the big picture of what you are doing in the world around us, what you are calling us to? Would you help us to be a people who would trust in you and to be totally committed to what you have called us to? We ask this in your holy and precious name, we pray. Amen. As we close this morning, I want to remind you of a couple things. Again, Pastor Tim has his Next Steps class if you're planning to stay around for that. Next Sunday, we're also going to begin a new series called Kingdom Citizen. Downstairs, our Kingdom Kids is going to be talking about what a Kingdom Kid is. This is we're going to be going through the book of Ephesians. And so this coincides right with our new Sunday morning discipleship class, going through the book of Ephesians. So it's going to be a great opportunity to come, study the book of scriptures, come hear messages, and live out what Christ is calling us to as a kingdom citizen. And a kingdom citizen is a masterpiece. Also, if you haven't been engaged with it as well, we do have the Northside Weekly. It's in your bulletin. It's also online, emailed out every week. If you're not receiving that in an email, you'd like to, let us know in the church office. We also have the Facebook group about the Northside Weekly. If you're not on Facebook, you can still email into the church office your insights from what you're reading. Share with us what you're seeing, the connections in Scripture, what God is speaking to you in Scripture. But let's be a people who are engaging these Scriptures together to hear from our Lord and Savior. Would you stand with me today as we close our time and receive this blessing? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Would you go in that grace and peace and take your next steps toward Christ? Amen.
Every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every